All right, so it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sarah Monroe, who is a qualitative health services researcher with a focus on knowledge translation and implementation science in women's health. Dr. Monroe completed her graduate studies at the University of British Columbia and a post. And completed her a fellowship at Dartmouth Institute for Health Policy and Clinical Practice. Today, she is here to present how to do knowledge translation during a pandemic. So thank you, Dr. Monroe, for being here. I'm going to pass it over to you now.
Thank you so much. It is my absolute pleasure, and I want to thank the Foundation and Arthritis Research Canada for the invitation to present. When we first spoke about this talk, I was initially going to present on some of my work on knowledge translation with policymakers, but our world has transformed so dramatically in recent months that the results of that work just didn't feel as relevant now. So this in front of you is a series of pictures from Instagram that show recent street art from around Vancouver. And I think they demonstrate how our community has been transformed, how we're trying to make sense of the changes that the pandemic has brought. And I hope that by the end of this talk, as we enter the weekend, that my webinar on doing KT in a pandemic has delivered some of the messages in these images, that it's okay, we're still strong. And before we begin, I also want to acknowledge that I am presenting today from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people and what we now know as UBC's Vancouver campus, where I live and work. I also have a few disclosures to share. I receive consulting and grant funding from a number of sources, including grants from the Michael Smith Foundation. And any intellectual property that arises from these activities is my own. So today we're going to navigate how to do KT during a pandemic. I'll start by discussing some barriers to engaging in KT during the pandemic, and then I'll turn to methods for doing KT during COVID-19 with specific attention to case examples from my work in women's and children's health research. And by the end of the talk, I hope that you have new insights on how to select KT strategies that help accelerate the impact of research during the pandemic, whether it's COVID-related research or your own ongoing studies. Before we jump in, I just want to echo that this will be recorded, and I have a number of suggested resources throughout the talk. Please return to the slides after the talk in case I move ahead before you've jotted something down or a citation. Just note the slide number, and you'll be able to get the reference later. But when you signed up for this webinar, we asked you to complete a short questionnaire, which has helped to understand who is the audience for this talk, which is one of our first steps in KT planning. Most of you joining today are KT specialists or researchers. Not shown here, but we also have data that 50% of you identified as a beginner to KT practice in science. And we also have some international folks registered from the US, from New Zealand, Australia, Dubai, Brazil, and Denmark. And because of this diversity, I thought the most helpful way to begin would be to situate us on the same page with some common terms and a common language. So let's start with defining what we mean by knowledge translation. Knowledge translation practice is the dissemination and exchange of information and tools to specific audiences to increase knowledge and change behavior. KT science is the scientific study of that practice, to investigate the processes and factors that influence dissemination of knowledge to specific audiences. So when I talk about KT today, I'm referring to dissemination and exchange. I won't be touching on implementation or implementation science, or else we would be here for another hour. And I also want to point out that most of my work, and something we should all be familiar with, is integrated knowledge translation, which involves partnering with audiences and stakeholders throughout the research process. By working together from start to finish, the aim of IKT is to help accelerate the uptake of research evidence into policy and practice. You might be familiar with terms co-production or community-based participatory research. These are very similar and they sometimes overlap with IKT. Now, when asking the question, how do we do KT in a pandemic? What I'm really asking is how do we do KT in the context of COVID-19 in a way that pays deliberate attention to our audiences to the settings where knowledge is used, and the broader context of our healthcare system, which is operating during a pandemic. In return, KT practice and science have a huge role to play in helping to respond to COVID-19. We can help disseminate and exchange knowledge learnt throughout the pandemic. We can understand the context in which COVID interventions are used. We can help to understand the processes and the factors that influence how the public responds to public health recommendations, and how to work with policymakers to implement that evidence in a timely way. If you are curious and you wish to learn more about context and that critical theory, I recommend starting with these resources, which again, you'll be able to access after the talk. Now, turning back to how to do KT during the pandemic, let's map out our current location in the knowledge to action cycle. Now, some people, many of you here today, may have chosen to start new projects to look at COVID-19. This work, I am positing, is in the central funnel. It's part of knowledge inquiry and synthesis, identifying problems and generating evidence to bridge the COVID no-do gap. For many, though, we also have ongoing research, or we're supporting trainees where we need to pivot and now situate our work in the context of the pandemic. You might be joining here today because this is a very tough new context for disseminating evidence. As I am pivoting my program of research to continue during the pandemic, a lot of my efforts right now involve understanding local context and the factors that may influence the use of knowledge that's unrelated to COVID-19. And so now I'd like to do a poll. I'd like to see where you all are in terms of your work, and are you pursuing a new project related to COVID-19? So we'll wait for a few minutes while you respond, and then we'll get to look at the results. I feel like we need to have the Jeopardy theme song here. I'm not going to start singing. Ugin and Amrit, I didn't see the quick poll results, and it's showing up as 0% on my end. Still showing up as zeros on my end.
Hi, Sarah. Okay, sorry, so, I can just read. Yeah, sorry, go ahead, Amrit.
Oh, I was just going to say, I don't know the percentage, but there are quite a few people that say yes. And then,
okay.
Yeah.
Hi, right. Sarah. I can tell you the percentages. It's 47% that say yes, 22% say not yet, but I plan to, and 30% say no, I don't plan to.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. I know, just for everyone's knowledge, we get to see different versions of the screen. So if I could go back to the slides. I think that's really helpful for us to get situated in where we're at and what kind of knowledge we're looking for in terms of moving forward with KT. And it also gives us a sense of how rapid the uptake is, how we are moving forward with addressing issues related to the pandemic. So in that context, let's now look at some challenges and barriers to doing KT during the pandemic. And this should be relevant for you regardless of whether you have a new project in mind today, or you're pivoting to work on existing studies in the context of COVID-19. So this here is one of the signs posted around Pacific Spirit Park near my home. It's a lovely bit of science communication, and I'm going to stay on this slide and talk for a minute about the different barriers to KT we may be encountering. So working from home. Working from home and physical distancing means we're all staying 2 meters apart. There's no in-person KT. Conferences, classes, team meetings, these KT activities are almost all virtual now. Our audiences also have new and immediate information needs. Our ongoing studies may not have the same relevance now as just a few months ago. And the priorities around COVID mean that government has had to pivot hard and fast. If you work with government, your policy window may have recently closed or your grant competition postponed. And many faculty and staff in the research community have lost their jobs or are patiently waiting until they can get back in their labs again. Physical distancing has also had impact on partnerships with First Nations communities. Most rural and remote First Nations communities in BC have gone on lockdown, which can quickly lead to unintended consequences and inequities. It should force us to question, who has access to participate and collaborate in KT during a pandemic, and what does it look like? I also recognize that just like this talk, most of us are connecting and doing KT virtually, and we are so privileged to have that ability to be connected around the world at this time. But this method wasn't designed to be used day in, day out. And I just want to point out some evidence around this. Video conferencing exhaustion is a real thing. There was a very nice piece of KT in the Wall Street Journal recently where Jeremy Bailenson, a professor at Stanford, wrote about nonverbal overload. So for instance, one study he ran at Stanford showed that when people are exposed to large virtual faces, they flinch instinctively and physically. This may be a part of the reason why Zoom is so exhausting. For every minute we are in Zoom, we have staring faces inches from our own. But if we move too far back from the screen, our colleagues might think that we're disengaged. And so with that in mind, how do we do KT in a pandemic? It should be thoughtful and evidence-based. Rather than choosing what's available based on convenience, we should also choose the right method at the right time in the right context. So KT scientists joining us here, we have a chance to contribute to that science. And part of our KT during the pandemic may be more of this type of discussion, providing guidance to researchers on how to disseminate and exchange information effectively. So let's turn now to KT practice. In the following section, I'm going to walk us through 5 practical KT tips that may work during the pandemic and that take into account physical distancing and virtual modalities. Now, this is not an exhaustive list, and my suggestions will be familiar already to people who are KT experts. This is intended to be helpful for trainees and others who are early in their KT journey. As I go through this list, also think about whether these strategies might fit your KT needs. Do they work for your target audience and how they access knowledge? Do they match your KT goals, whether it's increasing knowledge or changing policy or informing new technologies? So first tip, write an opinion or an editorial for a newspaper or blog. The public is hungry for science right now, and this is our moment as scientists to take the spotlight and deliver key evidence-based messages. And I think the key here during COVID is what Sarah Efron is stating in her tweet, make it news hooked. Make it part of the conversation on what's being talked about in the news right now. And these here are some recent examples from my colleagues, Sky Barbeck and Jason Sutherland. Like me, they're scientists at the Center for Health Evaluation and Outcome Sciences, or CHAOS. Their op-eds here in local and national papers connect their programs of research to COVID-19, and they're news hooked in that sense. So 3 additional tips for researchers here. Have a co-author write the op-ed with you, especially if you're a trainee. Second, start drafting an op-ed related to your research when you have the time. And then when the news cycle aligns with your work and the timing is right to join in the conversation, edit and hook your draft to the news. And then finally, work with your communications teams. We researchers need help from skilled science communicators as well in writing quickly in plain language, so let's join forces. All right, next tip. Contribute to an inventory or an evidence repository. Tracking research projects in Canada, for instance, we have in BC, the Academic Health Sciences Network has a wonderful inventory. There's CanCOVID, which is pooling together critical resources and helping to reduce duplication in studies. COVIDEND, it's an evidence repository that has resources for decision makers, and it has an excellent collection of evidence syntheses. ReachBC is another resource. It's a new platform that can help connect patient partners and participants with researchers. And then finally, the foundation is going to be initiating a new COVID-19 research hub through KT Pathways. So please stay tuned for that. Next, number 3, use Twitter to extend the reach of your evidence. I think this is especially critical as conferences go virtual. If you're planning to present a poster online in the near future, consider using the Better Poster template. Here's an example. It's highly visual, the key message is highlighted, and it makes for easier reading online as well as in person. I also encourage folks to include their poster talk in a tweetorial. This comes from the term editorial. It's long-form Twitter, where you create a daisy chain of tweets that together form a thread of related ideas. It helps give context to your poster image. It can provide an overview of each of your poster sections. You can include your conference hashtags. You can include links to a web page with more information. And for anyone who is helping to organize a conference this year, consider also having a social media guide for your attendees. You can also create a poster-specific hashtag that you can use in addition to your conference's hashtag. Next, number four, create an infographic and disseminate it via news media. Here I'm including an example from Julia Marcus and Ellie Murray, who you may know on Twitter as EpiEllie. They created this quick infographic that shows the different scales of risk of transmission of COVID. Now, writers at Vox saw this on Twitter and then asked if they could convert it into a professionally designed version. Again, this is an example of a lovely partnership between scientists and communication experts. It's news hooked. It's very easy to disseminate. And if you aren't an expert in graphic design, you can always suggest an idea to your communications team and they can help you to create it. And now finally, and this is the most ambitious suggestion, create a short documentary or video. Here are some examples from the ITSE Talks competition. These are short 2-minute videos that present evidence-based messages related to the health of children, youth, and families. And why is this medium important right now? Well, I'll get to that in my next section on KT Science. And first, in summary, before I start talking about the evidence behind that method, let's look at what we've learned here. Choose the right method at the right time in the right context. Some of these approaches are more resource, time, and cost intensive, but all have value. If you're a researcher and you don't know if there's value in doing KT right now during the pandemic, remember, it helps to build your reputation and everything, absolutely everything, goes on your CV. Please list it all. Before selecting a KT strategy, though, I recommend returning to KT best practices. Go back to your KT planning template, or as I've done here, go back to the knowledge to action cycle and consider how you can adapt your knowledge to this new context and what are the barriers and facilitators to reaching your KT goals. So I'm going to turn now to an example from my research in KT Science, and this looks at what influences the dissemination and exchange of knowledge to audiences in maternal and child health. So this is getting into the science of the practice. Now here in BC, I'm a member of the BC Support Unit Methods Cluster for KT and Implementation Science. I have the privilege of leading a project for the cluster to understand how documentary works as a method of KT for parents of young children. The documentary was recently adapted from the book Let Them Eat Dirt. It takes viewers on a 1-hour journey about the microbiome and how it impacts childhood health. For parents of young children, our hypothesis was that a documentary is going to be easier to engage with than a book, but we also wanted to know how does it work. With my research team, I wanted to know how it would work to spread knowledge and for whom and what contexts and why. And we were also curious to know how parents would engage with a documentary, especially as people are shifting their viewing habits, turning to streaming services and doing more on their phones. So for instance, in Canada, nearly all adults under the age of 45 use the internet daily, and they use a smartphone or tablet. These are devices that move with you inside and outside the home. We also have international evidence from a survey conducted with 613 women from 24 countries. During pregnancy, the majority of women use the internet to supplement information from their providers, and they use that information to inform decision making. And the factors that influence them to access the internet, they include dissatisfaction with the information they get from providers and a lack of time in asking questions. And in turn, the information they get online increase their confidence in decision-making. For our research, this meant a documentary shared on the internet may have greater reach with parents than through other media. Our study is a realist evaluation
and we're seeking to identify best practices for producing future documentaries involving health research evidence. It involves two interviews with 27 participants each from across Canada, and we oversampled to ensure that we had diversity in both rural and urban communities and across ethnicities. We're in the analysis stage, and I can share some preliminary results. And for you today, the question may be, should I invest in doing KT using a video or documentary? And the answer is, it depends. We've learned that for parents, short formats work best. So less than an hour, ideally in 2 to 5 minute chapters, so that they can pause when needed. Parents also don't actively seek out educational videos, and they more frequently stumble upon them via social media or their YouTube algorithm suggests something to view. So our dissemination strategies have to be nimble and anticipate how parents may passively encounter new media. Parents also value story-driven, relatable content that draws them in with discovery and new knowledge. They're looking for an aha moment that satisfies their curiosity and makes them feel like they're learning something. Parents lead busy lives, even during normal circumstances. But at the same time, in our interviews, which were conducted before the pandemic, they self-reported spending roughly 3 hours per day online in their spare time, primarily on their phone. Our participants who were off work on maternity leave reported engaging with their phones even more, especially while they had their headphones in during feeding and nap time. They valued having media on demand that is easy to pause and play, that's free, that autoplays when you're scrolling by, and that has subtitles, which I think is pretty critical. It's more accessible that way, so you can watch while your baby is sleeping. We also heard from rural participants how important it is to be able to download media like podcasts, to be able to listen during long drives, because the alternative is listening to the one CBC station that is only intermittently available. Now, we're about to conduct further interviews to see how these habits may have changed for participants as a result of the pandemic. And finally, our analysis indicates that watching documentaries led to parents feeling entertained, gaining new knowledge, and sparking intentions to try things out. In this study, actual behavior change was not something we were exploring. That was not the KT goal of the Let Them Eat Dirt documentary. But we know from research from other groups in Canada and from market research that for behavior change, shorter is better. So key messages with easy actions and practical steps that lead to specific outcomes packaged in 2 minute videos, that's ideal if there is a specific behavior change or action that you hope your KT tool to achieve. I also want to highlight some work that my brilliant PhD student, Kate Wall, is also leading. She's working on a new study to explore the role of storytelling and narrative in health policy during the pandemic. And I hope that we can share the results of that work with you soon. So again, choose the right method in the right time, in the right context, and match the method to your KT goal, your audience, and your key message. So in this next section, I'm going to talk about a different approach, integrated knowledge translation, or IKT, which is partnering with audiences throughout the research process. If you work with different stakeholder groups, I imagine things look a bit different right now. You may be meeting less, you may not be meeting at all. But now more than ever, we need to strengthen existing relationships. One of the strategies I've adopted is a set of questions for my partners based on the existing literature and my own experience in doing KT for the past 15 years or so. Reach out to your partners and ask, what are your priorities right now? If you have a request for them, if you're preparing a grant and need a letter of support, explore their capacity to participate and have a discussion about what would be feasible. And if they have new priorities, be reciprocal and ask, how can I support this work? It's important to listen to stakeholders' needs and have them be involved in developing solutions. There is right now a dangerous potential for partners to be shut out, especially patient partners and Indigenous communities and clinicians who are busy working on the front lines. So let them lead you into a new relationship. What worked before may not work now, so we need to bring an equity lens to our KT.
for research and KT that is currently essential, that is moving forward, you may have time-sensitive requests for instance, letters of support. So my suggestion is to be very clear about your ask up front. What is the problem you're addressing together? What is your role? What is their role? And what resources do you have and what you're asking for? Some practical tips for reading the room and understanding what your stakeholder partners need and want. This includes observing and using your partner's language. So for me, I've learned recently that with health authorities, I need to speak in terms of disaster planning, evaluation, and public-facing materials. Another strategy is to teach back. Are you hearing things correctly? Empathize and watch for signals. Look for invitations and questions where you can help. If you put an offer out, pay close attention, be empathetic, and understand if they're responding and taking some time to interpret it. Why is that? And always finish your meetings. Is anything else going on? Is there anything that I'm missing? And oftentimes I'll get an email 10 minutes after our meetings with, oh, I forgot to mention this opportunity. I think it would work out perfectly. So make space for that. Just give you an example here. Back in April, about a month after we began to work from home, I reached out to my partners in government and I asked if there was anything I could do. And I got some very quick responses that ranged from, we've had reports about a certain patient experience. Can you confirm it with data? Others said, I'd love some brain power. And others said, I'm grateful that you reached out. And one even noted that I was the only researcher to contact her. And it gave us the space to quickly submit a grant together based on the core priority for her team. For another partner, I wrote up a quick evidence synthesis based on the knowledge gap that she identified, and they've used it in provincial maternity service planning meetings. So again, the lessons here, take home message for IKT, partner with people throughout the research process, which then begins my last section on equity, diversity, and inclusion. Partnering with people in the research process requires an equity lens. So let's have our final poll question. And I'm curious to know, have you met or connected with patient partners since physical distancing started in mid-March? Again, insert Jeopardy theme song. Okay, I think we may have our results. And can I ask someone from the Michael Smith team to read them out for me?
Hi, Sarah, I'll jump in here. We have 45% who say yes. 21% say not yet, but I plan to, and 34% say no, I don't plan to.
Okay, great. Thank you everyone for sharing. I don't want to downplay how hard patient engagement can be. It is certainly a skill, but it is also a very rewarding thing to do, and it's the right thing to do. I want to shout out here the parent advisory group that collaborates with our team. We've been continuing to connect remotely. For many of them, I know that evenings after the kids have gone to bed, that's the best time for many of these parents to connect. And I'm quite inspired by how willing they are to show up and how much they want to participate in research. And as we got our feet under us and are exploring new ways to connect with patient partners, I revisited this and I want to recommend this paper to you by Holly Whitman and colleagues. And this beautiful infographic just has a lesson to trainees out there. It was adapted by Bryn Robinson at Bryn PhD in New Brunswick, not a co-author on the study. And I just want to say thank you for making my job easier by creating and disseminating this. So first off, one lesson for our context today. Don't be afraid to have a full team meeting as soon as possible with your patient partners, where you can establish a culture where their views are still valued during the pandemic. And also, I would say facilitating good communication means also connecting one-on-one or in small groups by phone, which can actually offer more privacy to do it by phone and less pressure compared to video conferencing. And it may also be more affordable for folks who have limited data plans, especially in rural and remote communities. Next, I think now is a time to think about KT and patient engagement for the long term. So what are sustainable methods we can use for the coming years? Because we might be here for some time. This includes partnering with the most marginalized or people for whom the system makes it hard to engage as a patient partner because of geography, their language, accessibility, or age. Early data we know now suggests that COVID-19 disproportionately affects people of color in part because of systemic barriers to accessing care. It's really critical to partner with patients and partners who are most affected. They can provide insight into stigma, into structural barriers, solutions for public health messaging, and for redesigning the healthcare system. I also want to talk about accessibility. So we've seen some amazing shifts in making work more accessible in the past few months. So working from home, flexible set schedules, reduced documentation. These are all things that have been requested for a very long time by disabled and chronically ill people, by parents and by caregivers. And I hope that we don't return to a world in which accessibility is ignored. I also have some personal experience here, good and bad, with working from home. And I like to share this experience, especially for trainees. So I'm a parent to twin boys, and I spent most of my research career working from home without childcare, or working from my car office while running them between activities. I was also a single parent while I wrote my dissertation, and I did most of my work scattered between the hours of 8 p.m. and 6 a.m. And during my PhD journey, I felt the need to hide this as much as possible from faculty other than my supervisors. And then later, I did half of my postdoc remotely, and I was told by people, even other academic mothers, that I shouldn't count on getting a faculty job. Moving forward, I hope that KT Practice and Science can share and celebrate creative adaptation, especially for the next generation of KT scientists. I hope that we continue to build back better and keep these innovative changes in place that can make KT more accessible. And now we're coming to the end of my talk. We've covered common barriers to KT during the pandemic, KT methods, and other strategies to accelerate research impact. I have a quick postscript for us. During the pandemic, there has been a rush to conduct new COVID-19 related research, and it needs to be accompanied by strong KT. You may see a version of this meme online, and yes, this is true in part, and I am part of this as well. I'm on half a dozen new COVID grant applications from the last month alone, and this is not inherently a bad thing. We do need strong science and collaboration to address the effects of this pandemic. At the same time, there is a huge potential for waste, in part because of KT gaps. So for example here, as of early May, there were over 1,000 COVID studies on clinicaltrials.gov. None were related to critical non-drug interventions. And also, the first hydroxychloroquine study that was in March, it was poorly designed. It was cited 520 times, while well-designed studies have received less attention. The story has some lessons for all of us and some opportunities for better KT. Don't oversell early results, don't hype the research, don't make hasty decisions, and listen to the scientists. So before you go off and you start planning your next KT masterpiece, stop and consider, is now the right time? How would this fit in with my priorities? Especially if you're an early career researcher juggling more than you can take on, or if you're a trainee trying to finish your dissertation. Also think, what do my partners need? So for instance, one last anecdote. I approached some of my clinical partners recently with what I thought was a fantastic idea. I offered to create an infographic to accompany a clinical practice guideline that they were about to publish. We had done very similar work in the past, and we've collaborated a lot over the past 4 years. So when they replied with a hard no, we don't have the capacity to integrate an infographic right now, I didn't take it personally, and I listened. They are the experts in their clinical community, and they also have competing priorities right now. So we picked a different strategy. And now what we're proposing to do is disseminate the guideline via an email listserv for that specific group of care providers. It will still have a visual hook, and it will get the key guideline messages across, but it will be in a simple way that fits the capacity that my partners have right now. Giving my partners what they need and supporting each other and focusing less on what I think will work, that is so critical right now. And as we wrap up, I just want to leave you with this question from CDC's Mary Hines. And here's the view from one of my last fieldwork trips to the north. I miss you all and stay safe. And thank you so much to the different organizations whose funding and resources have supported the work that I've presented today. And I'd love now to know your thoughts and have some discussion. Thank you. I will turn it over to the Michael Smith team.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Monroe, for a very relevant and insightful webinar. I think that when you mentioned that we need to just pivot right now and kind of adjust our perspective, that is really important for us to know. So we'll just get started with the Q&A period. And so all participants are welcome to now submit their questions in the question box. So we do have some that have come in regards to communications. So you did mention a lot of different methods and how we can disseminate our research, such as using documentaries and other media outlets. But for researchers that maybe are not aware of how they can do that, do you have any suggestions on how they can find certain resources in within the communications teams? Like where would they even find a communications team in their department? Or if they should invest in hiring a communications professional and what skills they should look for when looking for that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Where do you start? Well, I don't know what resources are available in this person's institution, but at UBC, there are a range of different resources. So, and some of them are free, some of them have a cost attached. So when it comes to developing video, I often will budget to work with an external designer. I know of a number of different documentary filmmakers and as well a graphic designer who works in whiteboard animation. I didn't identify them myself. I spoke with colleagues who were experts in the area and they referred me to these individuals. So one was through at the Center for Health Evaluation and Outcome Sciences. We do have a communications team. I said that I wanted to do a recording of some of my patient engagement, and they got in touch with a program, a post-secondary program, where there are Indigenous filmmakers in training. So that was one example. Another is learning from somebody who had given a talk like this. And I asked them, where did you find your whiteboard animator? And they put me in touch. Most universities will have communications teams and specialists. And I think that it's good practice to connect in and build network locally and support people in the community, especially trainees that are learning. If you are curious to actually get started, feel free to send me an email. I'm always happy to brainstorm about different ways to connect in with these experts.
All right, thank you so much, Sarah. I think you're right. We need to start looking within our community and going from there to see what other resources are out there. So we have another question about patient partners. So do you see the relationship with patient partners changing over time? And how do you keep them engaged over a longer period of time?
I think the role of patient partners, what I've learned really through the BC Support Unit and some of the methods cluster projects that I've been involved in, is that there is really no one size fits all approach, even within a project and a single patient partner or partners. So at the outset, there might be a lot of collaboration where you're truly partnering together in designing a study or a KT project. And then there could be a period of informing the patient partner, inviting them to participate further, and then empowering them at the end of the project to be part of the dissemination, so giving presentations like this on their own. So I think it can be fluid and negotiated. In terms of sustainability, I do think, especially for the patient partners that I work with, that we have to build infrastructure that makes it possible to sustain patient partnerships over a long period of time. So instead of working with one or two parent partners of young children, I work now with a group, and they are welcome to leave the group and go on after, say, a three-month period of partnering, and we will bring in new patient partners. And that, we've learned, is the best way to keep capacity going and sustainability.
Awesome, thank you. Have you had experiences offering webinars like this to your community partners, members? Where, this person is planning to transfer a pre-planned community symposium event into a webinar. Would this be an effective option, do you think?
I can't see why not. I think that asking the community members what are the ways that they're getting information and when and how, that might be a way to understand if it's a good fit for them, or even having them co-design the webinar content. If you have a patient or community partner involved in that process, I think that would always be an added bonus. I often don't, you know, when we're talking about prioritizing KT, I think it's important to what I've done here is I will take up invitations from people. I often don't throw myself out there and say I volunteer my services to do webinars and such. And I think that's just a management thing. So think about prioritizing what's going to be the best use of your time, what's going to be the biggest bang for your buck in reaching your KT goals. I'd love to have a further discussion. So if you wanted to contact me, we can always talk through your specific example a little better.
All right, thank you. I just do want to mention that we did decide to extend our question and answer period. So we will be finishing the webinar at 1 instead of 12:45. So you are more than welcome to answer or ask more questions. All right, so someone has asked, so many COVID-19 funding opportunities are focused on impact, which often involves influencing policy and practice. How to identify and reach out to policymakers when you don't already have these connections?
That's a fantastic question. I think one of the things that I learned really early on from my mentors is the importance of taking a short-term and a long-term approach. So in the short term, it's going to be very difficult to develop trusting relationships that are brand new. So I would suggest working through a network like CanCOVID, where you can connect in with the researchers first, who are the gatekeepers, who have those relationships that can be a bridge to policymakers. So it shouldn't be your responsibility at this stage to develop those new relationships. And that can lead into your long-term approach. Many of the policymakers that I work with, we have been collaborating for 5 years. And it, I think, takes a couple of years to really build up that trust to the point where you can email or call somebody, connect with them by first name and say, hey, what's up? How can I help? And now is potentially a time to start that process, working through a network and people who have those trusted relationships, thinking of it as a long-term investment. We are going to be here for the long term, so now might be a good time to start.
All right, thank you. Next question. So this person is in comms and design, and they are in a KT role full time, but they're having a difficult time reaching some researchers due to their beliefs around the usefulness and impact of simple language KT pieces. Do you have any tips or suggestions?
Again, I think finding a trusted person. So who is the influencer among those researchers and that research community who can demonstrate and be a champion for plain language writing? It's always easier to work with somebody who already has that buy-in and can be your champion than to try and change hearts and minds altogether. So that would be my suggestion. A lot of these questions are making me come up with suggestions for networking and going to trusted individuals. I think that's a really important takeaway. Individually, we aren't necessarily able to create the changes that we want to see. So work with the people who you know are already on side with you and leverage their trusting relationships.
All right, thank you. Another question. So outside of proactive outreach, can you suggest some strategies for increasing policy influence right now, given the overload of COVID research and info?
See if I understand the question correctly. Strategies for influencing policy? Do you think that's what the question is referring to?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Strategies for influencing policy. Well, one way to, this is just, you know, if you're really starting out, I think keep in mind where policymakers get their evidence. Every government official or government office gets a brief in the morning of what has come from the news media that references their work. So if you want to get the attention of a specific office, write an op-ed or contribute to a news article where you speak about their work. And I would always suggest, including a balance of tone. Start out by showing what's being done well and as well where there's opportunity for improvement. That's one way to spark policymakers' attention and for them to recognize that you might be an expert who can contribute in that area. With the BC Ministry of Health, I know that there's been a lot of work to create linkage and exchange with the research community. I think the BC Academic Health Sciences Network is a great place to start. They have a lot of resources there for connecting researchers and policymakers and being that bridge between academia and government. So that might be another starting point for understanding where to get in the door.
Thank you. So right now it's kind of an uneasy time and there's a lot of shifts going on with priorities. So in terms of KT for projects with clinical service providers who have now shifted their priorities due to the pandemic for at least this period of time, what suggestions do you have for balancing the needs and capacity of KT partners with the expectation of the existing projects?
That's a really tough one. This kind of goes into the implementation science realm. So if you're implementing a clinical intervention or doing KT in a practice setting, it's a different set of considerations than I think KT practice and KT science. And I didn't touch on it because I'm currently not doing my implementation science work. That research is being curtailed and for good reason. So my clinical partners that I work with, they have shifted priorities completely. The clinical intervention that we were going to be testing and evaluating this spring, it's on the shelf. And I think that that's okay. The way that we are navigating this together is working with our funders to see how do we adapt, how do we meet our requirements for the grant. Thinking also, we've only been here for a few months, so things may shift. We may go into a new phase of being able to do some part of the research. But what we're really focusing on right now is staying in touch. So it's that set of questions that I had there of asking reciprocally for your partners and get them to tell you what do they need right now and what is feasible. It's not possible to move forward until you have those conversations. And you can come up with some potential plans and strategies. Perhaps now is a time to pivot and do some grant writing where you bring them on board, maybe helping to convene a meeting that helps to meet their goals. There are other ways that we can work together. Unfortunately, and this is, you know, what I'm living with right now, a lot of this work has to just stay on pause, and we can keep our fingers crossed that things get better and they can start up soon.
No, for sure. Thank you. This one is about working with vulnerable people in BC. There are certain challenges when it comes to doing KT with people experiencing poverty in BC. How do you suggest working with these people? There needs to be more than monetary compensation.
Yeah, again, I think this is where, you know, long-term relationships are really important, especially people who are experiencing lots of different challenges in their daily lives. So when I work with, here's an example. So doing focus group with low-income moms in a small rural community, I work really hard to build a relationship with the community health workers and the social workers who provide them care and supports. And I ask what would be helpful. So often when we come together for a focus group, it will be with a big meal. So we'll share food together. I'll make sure that there's childcare available. We will not just talk about the content of the focus group, but also have a rich time afterwards for a debriefing where we get to socialize, we get to build further relationships, and then I can hear what else would be helpful and what are their priorities. I like to keep following up with that group and having that relationship and that pattern of connecting just take place over time. Sometimes we don't have the research funding to do it. So I try to do the best that I can to keep people updated on the research process, making sure that I'm sending a community report or that I call in during a session and check in to see how everybody's doing. And I mean, I took the cue from that example. I just, learned from the people who provided the community supports and from the women in the program. They told me what they needed. I didn't come in with many preconceived notions about what would work. And so that's what I would recommend is listen to the people that you're working with, and they're the experts. So let them guide you.
Okay. Just another quick question about to follow up on this. Is there a difference between community partners and patient partners, or are they synonymous?
Yeah, it's a bit of semantics. I think it should just be patient partner. The BC support unit defines patient partner not only as somebody who is directly receiving care, but also the caregivers and support people who are involved in providing care for patients. Community partner, patient partner, really I'm meaning the same thing. And patient partner is the term that we're typically using in BC.
Okay, thank you. Which KT platforms do you recommend to sending opinions and editorial pieces to parents? So this person asking is a KT specialist for a research group that is interested in the health and wellness of children during COVID-19.
Oh, that's great. So one thing that I didn't talk about in this presentation around KT science, I often will do an update to my stakeholder maps pretty frequently. So stakeholder mapping is a strategy to understand who are the individuals and the organizations who have a stake in the game with the evidence that you're hoping to exchange. And that is something that I tend to develop in partnership with people who I already have existing stakeholder relationships. So I'll go with people who were previously involved in research, and I'll ask them, where do you get your information and what are your trusted sources? I think right now I'm leaning a lot on the KT specialists that I work with at CHAOS and with the Women's Health Research Institute, because people's online habits are changing. They're looking at looking at different information at different times. So in BC, I've been disseminating using the maps that they've developed and the list of different stakeholder groups. And that has been really helpful as well for ensuring that I'm not duplicating my efforts based on what somebody has already done before. Just to give you an example, in pregnancy and childhood well-being, there's the BC Association of Pregnancy Outreach Providers. Looping in with them, they have lots of, it's a wonderful network. So even though they have in a provincial capacity, they're connected in with different local networks as well. What works in an urban community for disseminating can be different in rural. So urban pregnancy and moms, I tend to go through Twitter and certain Facebook groups. In rural communities, I connect in sometimes with the local buy and sell, because that's where most people are online with their Facebook groups, the local buy and sell, just as an example. But I would say, you know, connect in with people who are already doing this work and try and learn from them and their stakeholder maps.
Awesome, thank you. And so, like, thank you so much for answering all of these questions and for offering to stay longer for this webinar. We just have one last question before we'll end it off. So this is what they said. So thank you for mentioning the importance of working with communities most affected by COVID-19. I do some qualitative health-related research with incarcerated and formerly incarcerated people, and I'm wondering if you happen to have any examples or other suggestions for useful and innovative KT strategies for health research in this context.
That's a great question. I personally don't have experience doing research in KT with incarcerated or previously incarcerated people. I want to shout out, I'm not sure if this is a question from Martha Painter. I want to shout her out. She is a nurse, a Vanier scholar, and a PhD student at Dalhousie University who does wonderful work in this area. And I would have to defer to her. So please get in touch with me if you'd like to have some specific suggestions about how to engage in that kind of KT at a community level.
All right. Okay, so that concludes our question and answer period. But before we wrap up today, I do want to sincerely thank you again, Sarah, for offering this really relevant and insightful webinar with us today.
Thank you very much. It was my pleasure. And again, if anyone would like to follow up, please get in touch. It was a delight to connect, and thank you again to ARC and to the Foundation for inviting me to be here today.
Perfect. So for everyone that has joined us today, I'd like you all to take a moment to answer our survey that will pop up after this webinar ends and will be emailed after. So your comments are really important to us to help improve with future webinars, so please take your time if you can to answer those. And for more information about KT and to explore supplemental resources, these links have been provided for you all. And one final reminder that all webinars will be recorded and archived at msfhr.org/ktconnects. So our next webinar titled Knowledge Translation and Behavioral Change Science, Building Community in a Pre- and Post-Pandemic World, presented by Dr. Jasmine Ma, will be on June 26th, and we hope you'll consider joining us. So again, that concludes our webinar for today. Thank you everyone on the line again for being here and joining us, and we hope to see you again next month. Have a great day. You're now free to disconnect.